Near the middle of the field, a Colours player is about to cross into White's half. He cannot be offside. The ball is passed to him when he is in his own half. The umpire checks to see that there are three defenders to his right because a Colours player has now moved into the picture. But he is onside because he still has those three defenders in between him and the goal line. If, however, the player moves ahead of one of these defenders, the umpire is able to see that he is in an offside position, and when the ball is passed to him, he becomes offside. A free hit is awarded to the other side. The experienced player waits in his original onside position and runs forward as the hit is taken. He is onside when he collects the ball, although there are now only two defenders between him and the goal line. If the umpire is of the opinion that a defender is likely to intercept a pass to an attacker in an offside position, he will not blow his whistle, allowing play to go on if the defender plays the ball. Here we see the ball hit away from the player in an offside position who does not materially affect play. The umpire must always be watchful for the changing positions of the defenders. Here, one has run back to bring the three defenders into position again, and the Colours players therefore are played onside. The umpire will allow play to continue. Many offsides occur at the roll-in, particularly near the goal line. Here, an attacking player with only two defenders between him and the goal line when the ball is rolled to him is offside. In a similar situation, the ball is rolled to another player who is onside and who passes the ball to another part of the field. The umpire should disregard the offside position and play would proceed. Again, the white player is in an offside position if he is in line with the third defender, but the umpire would disregard him if no advantage is taken of his position. No attacking player can be in an offside position if he is behind the roller-in. From a Colours roll-in, whites obtain possession and advance towards goal. The white forward, approaching the goalkeeper, passes back to a player of his own side and now finds himself in an offside position. Here he materially affects the play of the defenders. In a similar situation, if the player in the offside position moves away from the action, he should not be ruled offside. White's attack and a shot is made at goal. The ball strikes the goalkeeper's pads. The rebound carries to another white player who is in an offside position. His shot goes into goal. But the goal is not allowed because the ball only rebounds off the goalkeeper. If the goalkeeper stops the shot and deliberately plays the ball, the white player is played onside and the goal is scored. In exactly the same way, a defending player deflects a ball in the direction of an opponent in an offside position. That player is offside. But if the defender deliberately plays the ball in the same situation, the opponent is played onside and the game continues. In this case, a goal is scored. If a shot by an attacker strikes any part of the face of the uprights or crossbar and rebounds to another player of the same side, this is considered a direct pass, and the white forward, already in an offside position, is ruled offside. Note that a defender uses the free hit immediately to make a useful pass to a player in a favourable position. Play resumes on the other side of the field. Watch this hit carefully. Did you see the backsticks? Watch again. This time, he reverses his stick and hits it correctly. Now the player is tackled by an opponent who has slipped, and we see him on the ground swinging his stick flat side downwards at the oncoming player. Only the flat face of the stick may be used. From the free hit, the ball travels to a group of players, one of whom raises his stick high over his shoulders both on the back lift and forwards. This is dangerous, and he is penalized for sticks. With his stick raised high, the Colours player menaces the approaching opponent, and he is justifiably penalized for intimidation. For this dangerous obstruction of an opponent attempting to tackle back, the player is penalized. In all these cases, the penalty is a free hit to the opposing side. The free hit is taken, and the ball is lifted towards a group of players. This time, the ball is hit into the ground and it rises sharply. The ball may not be undercut or lifted dangerously. Watch this demonstration of these 2 points. Notice the incredibly high backswing and the chopping action as the angle stick head meets the ball. Also the high follow through. Undercutting is forbidden. Now the bounced ball, where the stick head squeezes the ball against the ground and it rises sharply. This stroke is often dangerous. The scoop stroke is permissible, but it too can be dangerous. Watch this defender attempt to get out of trouble by scooping the ball at the oncoming opponents. Dangerous play. This time, the same player scoops the ball so that it drops into a group of players, any one of whom might be tempted to swing his stick at the ball, thus leading to dangerous play. Correctly done, it is permissible, and here the defender cleverly puts his team on the attack with a well-timed scoop stroke. Only to be stopped by an opponent who plays the ball high in the air. How may a player stop a ball? First of all with his stick, either on the ground or in the air. Below shoulder height, of course. He may use his foot to support his stick, but not during a tackle by an opponent. The supporting foot must be removed before the opponent's tackle is made. The ball may also be stopped on the ground with the hand, but it should not move appreciably after the attempted stop. This is a knock-on, as is this attempt to stop a high ball. Here the ball should be caught in the hand. It should not be placed on the ground, but released immediately so that it drops vertically to the ground. During general play, a defender on colour's side flicks a ball which accidentally strikes one of his own players. This was quite unintentional, and the umpire ignores the resultant propelling of the ball. Similarly, if white, whilst dribbling the ball, and pursued by a defender running alongside, attempts a center and the ball strikes the defender's foot without appreciable rebound, there is no breach of the rules. Play continues until we see a ball hit in the direction of an oncoming white player who cannot avoid the ball, and it is kicked forward, very much to his advantage. The whistle goes for a free hit to colors. If, however, the colours player hits or lifts the ball, as in this case, into the body of his opponent, a free hit is given against colours for dangerous play. The game continues. From the 16-yard hit, whites gain possession, but an opponent, using a scything action with his stick, robs him of the ball. Free hit against colours for stick interference. 2 further examples of stick interference, holding an opponent's stick down or hooking over. Lifting an opponent's stick. But the umpire must delay his whistle in case the player attacked overcomes the obstruction and recovers possession. Now we come to a different form of obstruction. A white player moves on to a pass as his opponent advances. White places himself between the ball and his opponent, who is therefore obstructed. But in a similar situation, if the defender shows no intention of moving to the ball, there is no offence by the attacker, who carries on to shoot at goal. In this sequence, white receives the ball early and shields it with his body as he moves into the circle, a clear case of obstruction. Defenders are also capable of obstructing, and here the colours defender places his stick in an obstructive manner across the body of the oncoming opponent. A penalty corner. If a defender pushes the attacker with his shoulder or hand, and so prevents a goal being scored, a penalty stroke. But here the umpire awards a penalty corner for obstruction. A clever defender can get out of a lot of trouble with a really good reverse stick tackle, like this one. And gaining possession, he moves upfield, followed by the umpire. There are still more obstructions to consider, and here we see the colours defender receiving the ball and turning left to shield it from his opponent. A penalty corner. Here, the white player pushes the ball through the defender's legs and runs into him. Colours player is not obstructing. This is rough play by whites. A free hit. Frequently, a defender tries to clear to his right, forgetting that an attacker may be rapidly approaching. Obstruction and penalty corner. Seeing the ball off is a favourite pastime of backs and halfbacks, which the observant umpire will penalise for deliberate obstruction. A penalty corner. Goalkeepers are capable of doing it too, but it is an obstruction which leads to a penalty stroke. The umpire points to the 8-yard spot. Sometimes the goalkeeper mistimes his obstruction and the attacker has time to run round him to score. The umpire must therefore be prepared to delay his whistle. Obstruction can also occur at the bully. First, the half turn to left to push the ball away. Then the pull back and turn right, shielding the ball. To push the ball through the opponent's legs is not an obstruction, but the opponent may make it so by pushing the other player off the ball. We still see players who, in moving backwards, pull the ball between their feet. Obstruction at the roll-in is frequently missed. Here, the outside right obstructs the defender behind him. There is no obstruction when the player moves forward to meet the ball. On the left side, once again, obstruction. And once again, there is no obstruction when the player moves forward to meet the ball. In this roll-in, the outside left gains possession, moves upfield, and on the run, turns to centre just as the right defender moves into tackle. Obstruction. The same player in a similar situation often pulls the ball back as he turns to hit, with the same result, free hit to whites. Occasionally, players are guilty of trailing the ball on their right. Obstruction. Players sometimes pull the ball to their left to avoid a tackle. This is obstruction. One of the more difficult obstructions to see is the third man obstruction. White makes a through pass for his colleague and two defenders try to intercept, one crossing the path of the incoming white player, who hesitates, giving the second defender just sufficient time to clear the ball upfield. Obstruction running in between. The resultant free hit leads to an attack on colour's goal, and we see a number of things which the goalkeeper may or may not do. He may not kneel on the ball. Or fall on it. Or hold it between his feet. For any of these obstructions, he is likely to incur a penalty stroke decision by the umpire. He may kick the ball out of the circle, but in doing so, he is not entitled to kick it dangerously at an oncoming opponent. Penalty corner. He may bring the ball down with his chest. As long as he does not propel it forward. He may stop the ball with his hand. Again, he must not propel it forward. Penalty corner. Sometimes he has to make the ball at the edge of the circle, but he may not kick the ball outside the circle. The penalty for a deliberate infringement within the 25-yard area is a penalty corner. From this penalty corner, the ball lodges in the goalkeeper's pads. Play stops because the ball is dead. Since inside the circle, no bully may be taken within 5 yards of the goal line, we see the umpire measuring the distance for the bully in position in order to restart the game. During this time, we see the umpires confirm a 2-minute check, 2 minutes more to play. Another penalty corner follows, and the shot at goal is stopped by a defender's foot. In the umpire's opinion, this positioning was intentional, and he signals a penalty stroke. He stops his watch for the duration of the penalty. Except for the defending goalkeeper and the attacking player, all other players go beyond the 25-yard line. White scores a goal, and the players move to the center bully. As the watch is restarted, the players bully off. Play moves to the opposite end of the field. The goalkeeper's stick is knocked out of his hand, but he continues to play the ball. If a goal is prevented, a penalty stroke. But here the umpire awards a penalty corner for an infringement in the circle. The umpire gives the 1-minute signal. He sees a defender over the 5-yard line and motions him back. The ball is cleared upfield. The final whistle is heard, and the players leave the field. It is customary for the captains of the two teams to thank the umpires for their services. Finally, we see the umpires checking their record cards of the match. In the comparatively short time at our disposal, many points regarding the rules have been made, and inevitably some have been omitted. As we said at the beginning, we have tried to select the most important, and we hope that what has been shown will prove to be helpful. Having seen this film, we feel sure that players will appreciate more readily the efforts of the umpires on their behalf. On the other hand, umpires should remember that by their wise and skillful application of the rules, not only can they greatly improve the standard of play, but also the enjoyment of the players during the game.